So, hello my fellow book eggs, Megan here, and time for another book review. Today, I'm going to be talking about The Glass Sword by Victoria Aveyard, and this is book two in the Red Queen series. So, I really enjoyed The Red Queen, and I, like most series, was a little hesitant and worried when I went to The Glass Sword, worried that I wouldn't live up to what I hoped it would be. But you think I learned by now that I really shouldn't doubt myself with that kind of stuff, because I really enjoyed this just as much as The Red Queen, maybe even a little bit more. And before I go into too much with the book itself, can we just talk about that cover for a minute? I don't know why, but I really like that cover. You know, just the crown with red and silver blood dripping down it. So we pick up pretty much right where we left off. Mare, Cal, and members of the Scarlet Guard are retreating from the castle. Mavin is a little prick, and just, they're running for their lives. I just thought this was a really good sequel, and I was not bored throughout all of it. Some parts weren't quite as exciting as others, but I was never actually bored. So there's not much I can say without going to spoilers. So without further ado, I'm just going to go into a spoilery bit. So if you have not read The Red Queen or The Glass Sword yet, I highly suggest you click away now and come back after you catch up. So where to begin? I thought the range of abilities that the new bloods have, and I just gotta say, I really like that term for the reds that have abilities. New Bloods, I thought, was nice. It was different. It shows that they are neither completely red, and they are definitely not silver either. They're their own little group. So just the wide variety of abilities that these New Bloods have, and how some of them are similar to silver abilities, but they are different enough so that, you know, there's something the Silvers haven't seen before. It's something they are not prepared for. And I did like how Cal was kind of hesitant to join the Scarlet Guard. Because, you know, he's a silver prince, no less. And he's never gonna really belong. Yes, he is useful to them for a few different reasons, but he will never be one of them. Even a lot of the New Bloods, especially the older New Bloods, are kind of like, eh, he's a big part. In the system that kind of keeps them and their people down. So of course they're not gonna accept him with open arms. And Cal, who has been raised as a Silver, who knows nothing but that life, he cannot fully understand how horribly they've been treated under Silver rule. Now, you know, Cal has been hesitant to stay with the Scarlet Guard because he's gonna have to fight against other Silvers. Despite the fact that, you know, those Silvers are going to be after his head since he's been labeled a traitor. So basically, anyone from his past life who sees him is going to try and kill him or catch him on sight. Meanwhile, Mare has been noticing that among Silvers and even among some of the New Bloods, she's seen as kind of like something else. She was working with the Silvers when she was pretending to be that lost princess. So she's kind of has an in with them, which, you know, makes them kind of wary, and her power is pretty strong. So people are kind of nervous about her as well. I really like how we learn more about the Scarlet Guard and how they are much more organized and things go deeper than anyone really expects. And I'm curious to see what other little surprises the Scarlet Guard has up their sleeves in the final book. And Killorn, what should I say about him? I wish I could say the mini semi-love triangle between him, Mare, and Cal. I really wish I could say I didn't see that coming, but it was a thing. I'm glad I wasn't very focused upon because just no. They have some more important stuff to worry about than some stupid love triangle. And I kind of had mixed feelings about the sparks between her and Cal too. But I do like how they were trying to, like, you know, not focus on it too much, because they do have more important things to worry about. And I find interesting how Mare still has some feelings towards Mavin, or at least feelings towards the boy she thought he was. Because, you know, she spent quite a bit of time with him, getting to know this false persona of his. He was kind of her friend while they were there. They were gonna be in this together, and then she has him turn and stab her in the back. So I guess it's only kind of natural that she doesn't hate him right away. Like, yeah, she knows that he isn't the same guy that she got to know. That was an act put on to trick her and use her. But it doesn't stop, the feelings right away. So, there's that little struggle there. And Mavin, I wanted to strangle that little jerk throughout this whole book. He's killing any new blood he can come across, or he even captures a few to be used as his own little personal army with the aid of his mother. Just, he's killing children, too. Little children. And that really sickens me. And just no matter what, he is not going to make a come around in my mind. Unless his mother is controlling him and making him do all this shit, there's no way he's gonna be redeemable in my eyes, if only for the killing of those children. I mean, that's not the only reason, but that's kind of the big reason here. And actually, now that I say it, it would be really interesting if that is what has been happening. If Mavin has been under his mother's control this whole time. But just based on how we end this book, I doubt that's the case. Unless there's more than one person in on this and controlling him. But no, just based on how we end things, it seems this is all him. He's been saying, leaving little notes to Mare, too, being like, "This will stop if you come back to me. I'm doing this for you, yada yada yada." So you are a sick and twisted little brat, Marvin. And the fact that he is also using a child army. In the last book, the recruitment age for Reds, the idle Reds, went down from 18 to, what was it, 15 or 16. So any person that age who is an apprentice or whatever is going off to the battlefront. And a lot of them are not getting the full amount of training they're supposed to get either. So not only are these kids being put out on the battlefield, these poorly trained kids are. And apparently, this legion of children, which is being nicknamed the Little Legion, is gonna be sent off to the battlefield, basically used as a sacrifice to try and gain a little advantage in the battlefield. And I was a little horrified when Mare wasn't originally gonna do anything to stop it or try to stop it, because it would be a huge risk. And they wouldn't be able to get all the kids out of there, and just a thousand things could have gone wrong, and they were not prepared for this. But eventually, she does cave. Near the end, she does cave, and she's like, "Yep, come on, let's go save that little legion. Let's save those kids." But I'll get into that a little later. Mare also stages a quite impressive break in the Silver Prison, saving some more of the new bloods that Mavin has been catching, as well as busting out the Silvers who are not loyal to Mavin. Apparently, Mavin has been rounding up Silvers who have been questioning his rule and basically what he stands behind and locking them up. So Mare figures, okay, let's save those guys too, I guess. And also Julian and Sarah are there, and she wants to save them. Because they were nice to her. They are some of the few good Silvers she has met. And she doesn't want them to suffer because Mavin's a little prick. So they manage to save the new bloods, as well as a lot of Silvers who are against Mavin. They lost a few people in that battle. But you know what? They also managed to kill the queen. So that's gonna send a serious message all around, both to the Reds and the Silvers. Reminding the Silvers, yeah, you aren't invincible. We have the power and we can take you down. And showing the Reds, see, these guys aren't gods. They bleed and they die just like we do. And it also means that Mavin isn't gonna be quite as lenient with Mare now that his mother is dead. So yeah, also now Scarlet Guard has all these Silvers. So once these Silvers regain their strength, it's gonna be interesting to see what they do with the Scarlet Guard. Whether they handle, being mistreated like they are going to be, how they aren't gonna get the level of respect they're used to. So gonna be interesting to see if they try and overthrow the Scarlet Guard, or even if they join it, because they've been mistreated by their fellow Silvers. They've been locked up like common criminals, and pretty sure some of them were gonna be executed. So it's gonna be interesting to see where they fall. And before I move on, Shade's death. I died a little bit inside with that. Cause yeah, Mare has her family still, the rest of her family, her other two brothers, her sister, and her parents. But they don't fully understand her like Shade does. Shade was a new blood like her. They had that kind of bond to go on, and now that's gone. And not to mention, Shade was the closest to her even before they were new bloods, so that's gone. So yeah, Shade's death was a major blow, especially to the rest of her family too, because they thought he was dead in the last book. They thought he had been executed, and then to have him come back, and now to have him dead for good. It's just a hard blow, a really hard blow. So going back to rescuing the Little Legion. On their way to try and save these kids, they are caught by the Silvers. And Mavin, and he is there, and Mare sacrifices herself. She tells Mavin, let them go, and I'll go with you. And he agrees. So as far as we know, the others were let go. We don't know for sure, because Mare was kind of out of commission for a while. So she's kept unconscious for a while with this weird machine that Mavin has made that can actually, like, disable her more or less. Just the description of how that machine made her feel, like how she was dying, it like turned her power against her. Having her put through that, just my heart. So yeah, Mare's out of commission for a few days, and when she's brought out, she thinks she's gonna be executed very publicly, but instead Mavin does something a little worse. He basically makes her kneel before him, puts a collar around her, and she's basically gonna be his little pet, put on display for the world to see. You know, hey guys, look, Lightning Girl's back under my control. She's not my equal. These new bloods are dogs. So that, I feel, does leave a much stronger message than just killing her. Killing her would just probably give other Reds an excuse to push more than they are already. Killing her would be kind of like showing the sign, this girl's dangerous, I'm taking her out so that she is not a danger to us Silvers anymore. And that's kind of how we end things. We have no idea if the Little Legion was saved, we have no idea who's still alive after that last run-in with Mavin and his Silvers. We have no idea how the Scarlet Guard is going to be handling things and if they're going to be saving Mare or not. Like, I'm assuming they're going to save her. But we don't know how long she's going to be in as Mavin's pretty little pet. So that's going to be interesting to see. And just after that ending, I need the next book. Like, now. Like, I need to know what happens to Mare. So yeah, all in all, I thought this was an excellent sequel. And there's no doubt in my mind that I'm continuing on with this series. So yeah, that is it for this book review. And I hope to see you guys next time. Keep on reading, my fellow book addicts. Keep on reading.